Hi, I'm Jeff, and I'm a senior analytic trainer at SAS. In this video, I'm going to talk about transforming variables using SAS. Now, specifically, I'm going to talk about transforming input variables. But in business data, there's other variables that we might transform also. For example, in certain situations, we might transform the target variable. This is often done for distributional reasons. A common target variable in the business world is one that's binary. It just has two values: fraud, not fraud, churn, not churn, purchase, not purchase. And with a binary target, we often perform a logit link transformation on that target for modeling. We're going to be focusing on transforming input variables. Now, in a model, input variables can be categorical or numeric. Now, categorical variables in SAS lingo are often referred to as class variables, and class variables might be nominal or ordinal. And there are types of transformations that exist on the categorical variables. A relatively well-known one is weight of evidence, which takes a categorical input variable and transforms it to a numeric or interval input variable. But in this video, I want to focus on transforming interval input variables. Interval input variables, or interval in general, is the lingo in SAS for numeric input variables. Now, there's lots of different transformations that can be done on interval input variables. Many of them are mathematical, but not all of them. We can even do a binning transformation on interval input variables. But in this video, I'll focus on mathematical transformations. Now, why would we transform an input variable in general? Well, there's really a whole host of reasons, but one of the big ones comes down to model accuracy. If we have an input variable that is highly skewed or that has outliers, it can affect that model. It can actually lead to a model that's biased and therefore decrease its accuracy. So ultimately, the idea is we'll transform some interval input variables and hopefully end up with a better model when we do so. Let's go ahead and jump into some data. So in this data set, we're looking at organics data. So whether or not a customer at a grocery store has purchased an organics product. We've got a single target variable and it's binary, indicating whether or not an organics product has been purchased in the past. The input variables are demographic and some that maybe summarize prior purchase habits. Well, before we consider what variables to transform, we need to explore the variables initially. Maybe we don't have any variables that even need a transformation. So let's take a look. Initially here in Model Studio, we're on the data tab, looking at the variables themselves and the metadata, but I need to go to a pipeline. Now I've already got some work done in the initial pipeline. You can see that I've built a support vector machine as the machine learning algorithm to be considered, mostly picked arbitrarily. Right now though, let's focus on the results of the data exploration node. It's already been run. And we'll look at the results. Now there's two places where I can begin to investigate the interval input variables to see if any need to be transformed. Let me scroll down a little bit. And the first chart that I'm going to look at is the interval variable summary chart. And this chart is plotting skewness against kurtosis for our interval input variables. Skewness has to do with the shape of the distribution of a variable. Is it symmetric? Is it skewed to the right? Is it skewed to the left? And kurtosis has to do with how many observations or how thick or how thin the tails of the distribution are. If we're large in either of these two statistics, then that might be a variable that we need to consider transforming. And when I look at this plot, there's actually two variables that jump out at me. Promotion time in the upper right-hand corner. That one definitely looks problematic. The kurtosis value is a little bit more than 8, and the skewness value looks to be more than 2. And demographic affluence is one that I might want to consider also. Its kurtosis value is just greater than 2, and its skewness value looks to be just less than 1. Well, I can take a closer look at the distribution of these variables from within these results. Let me restore this chart. And then I'll go to the interval variables distributions chart and I'll maximize. And there's one of the two variables that we saw on the other display, demaffluence. Now, its skewness value was not as great as the other variable. So if we look here, that distribution is skewed to the right, although not greatly so. Definitely some of the larger values for this variable are stretched out, pulled out to the right. So this is certainly something we might consider transforming. Let's check that other variable that we saw earlier, promotion time. Remember, promotion time had a larger skewness value, so it's not surprising to see that on this plot, the distribution has even more of a right-hand skew or positive skew than the other one. Definitely, we'd consider transforming this variable. Now, in Model Studio, the way that transformations are going to be done is I'm going to go to the Data tab and assign a rule for transformation. It's like establishing metadata, but the transformation itself will be done by the transform node within the pipeline. So I need to get back to the Data tab. Let me close that chart and close the results. And again, go back to the Data tab. Now, one really nice thing about assigning these transformation rules is I can assign different types of transformations for different variables. So we saw that promotion time was the variable highly skewed to the right. Well, based on mathematical knowledge, I know that a log transformation is a really good transformation for dealing with a distribution that has a heavy right skew on it. So let me select promotion time. And in its properties panel, notice there's a property for transform. It currently says default. Well, let me assign that rule of log transformation for that variable. Again, we're only assigning the rule here. The transformation itself will be done within the pipeline. Now, demographic affluence was the other variable that we saw that might need a transformation, not as skewed as promotion time. Well, maybe I don't know what type of transformation to apply to this variable. It wasn't as skewed as the other one. Model Studio has a real neat type of transformation known as BEST, where actually multiple transformations are considered, and then based on some criterion, the best transformation is selected. So you don't really know what you're gonna get initially, but one is selected that is it thought to be the best for that variable. So with DemAffluent selected in the properties panel, I'll assign the rule of best transformation for that variable. Now let's go back to the pipeline. All right, notice the green check marks are now gone. That's because some metadata has been established in the data tab and would need to rerun the pipeline. Let me go ahead and add that transform node. I'll right click on the data node, add a child node, and add transformations. And let me select that node and we'll take a quick look at the properties. Well, notice that there is a property for class inputs. So we can transform the class or categorical inputs, but currently the default property for class inputs is none. That means no transformation on the class variables. For interval inputs, notice the default method says none. So typically, no transformation would be done on interval input variables unless there's a rule defined on the data tab. Any rules there are going to override the property that we see here. So we'll do a log transformation for promotion time, and we'll do the best transformation for DemAffluence. Let me go ahead and run that node. Now, if we set things up properly, I should only see two variables being transformed in the results. So it's kind of like a little way to self-check that we've set things up properly. All right, the node is done. Let's take a look at the results. There's the table of transformed variable summary. I'll maximize, and sure enough, only two variables have had transformations applied to them. Now let me explain the way that Model Studio handles metadata. The original variables, DemAffluence and promotion time, are still included in the data table, but the role has been updated to rejected. That doesn't mean they're deleted, it just means they're turned off and essentially ignored as we move forward in the analysis. And two new columns have been added. Notice that Model Studio has even logically named the new variables. SQRT or square root for DemAffluence and log for promotion time. So the square root transformation for DemAffluence is one that we didn't know up front, but using the best transformation method, it appears that that's the best transformation for that variable. Now, before we take a look at the exploration of these new variables and see that the skewness and the kurtosis issues have been mitigated, let's take a quick look at the formula column. Look at the formula for log promotion time. Notice that formula has an additional plus one in it, and that's known as an offset. By adding one to a value first and then doing a log transformation, it doesn't have a great effect on that final transformed value. But by adding one, it avoids the issue of taking log zero. The developers of Model Studio know that in the business world, often when we do a log transformation on a variable, there might be zero values contained. By having that offset, it immediately solves the issue of trying to take log of zero, which is undefined. So it's a good idea to have that in the software. Let me close those results. And I'll close the bigger results window also. And let's explore the variables before we build a model, just to visually check that the transformations have been performed. Again, I'll add another child node. Data exploration is under miscellaneous. And let me run that node. All right, green check mark, so results are ready. I'll right click and go to results. And let's look at those same two charts we did earlier. I'll scroll down a little bit and then maximize interval variables summary. Now keep in mind that the scale on each axis has changed. So we're still looking at skewness plotted against kurtosis. On the left-hand side, we see log promotion time, and on the right-hand side, we see square root demofluence. They still look to be far from the origin, but again, that's really just a function of the scale that we're looking at now. Log promotion time, we see that the kurtosis value is less than 0.5, and the skewness value is negative. Not a big deal, it just means that after the transformation, the distribution has a slight left-hand skew to it, and the skewness value looks to be about 0.2, negative 0.2. And for square root of the demofluence variable, the kurtosis value appears to be just a little bit greater than 0.5, and the skewness is around 0.2. Let's check the distribution of these variables before we build the model. I'll restore that window, and then we'll go to interval variable distributions. I'll maximize. We don't need to look at age. Let's look at log promotion time. Again, maybe a little bit of a left-hand skew, but not enough to be concerned with. Definitely the distribution of this new variable, much more symmetric than the original variable. And how about the square root of demographic affluence? And looking at that distribution, similar story, much more symmetric compared to what we had originally. I'll restore that plot, close the results window, and of course we want to do a fair comparison of the models, so I'll add a support vector machine after the transformation node. And I'll run the whole pipeline. Notice that the support vector machine node without transformations is just labeled as SVM. And the node that has the transform variables is called SVM1. So the SVM1 model is the model that has the transformed variables. We don't even need to look at each model individually. Model Studio automatically puts a model comparison node in the pipeline, and that's where we can see our final punchline. The run is complete. Let's take a look at results. And in this case, we're looking at misclassification rate to pick the champion model. And sure enough, support vector machine one, that's the support vector machine model with the transform variables, has the smaller misclassification rate. That means using this statistic, it is the better model. Now keep in mind that in data science, results are always data dependent, but in this case, it does look like transforming those input variables did give us a better performing model. So that's it for now. Please take a look at additional resources down below. In fact, post a comment, ask a question if you want to. Don't forget to join this channel and give me a thumbs up if you like this video. Hope you had some fun. Hope you learned some things along the way. That's it for now. I'll see you later.